各位議員，咁我哋
Members, we have a quorum and we've also reached the appointed hour. So, let's start. First, election chairman. This is the chairman of the Bills Committee on Employment Amendment Bill 2014. And we have to comply with 21E, which is in Appendix 4. Please nominate a member. We need one nominator and then one seconder, and the nomination has to be accepted by the nominee. Ms. Jun Kai, I nominate Mr. Kenneth Leung. Mr. Kenneth Leung. And then any seconder? Yes, Ms. Sit Ho. Mr. Leung, do you accept the nomination? Yes, I do. Okay, is there any other nomination? Mr. Wong Kok Kin. Any seconder, please? Mr. Kok Wai Kung. Mr. Wong Kok Kin, do you accept nomination? Yes, I do. So we have two nominations. Any more nomination, please? Is there a third nomination? We have already got two. If not, then we will have to cast the ballots. So there will be secret ballots. According to the rules of procedure, or rather house rules, each candidate will be given a candidate number, and then you will put a tick against the one you prefer. Number one is Mr. Kenneth Leung, and number two is Mr. Wong Kok Kin. So the voting begins. Have you got the ballot paper? There are 15 members present. Please, just put your ballot paper into the box.
好啊。咁我相信大家都已经喺选票嗰度盖咗。
Well, the voting is now closed. The clerk will not issue any more ballot paper. Please collect the ballot papers now.
Oh, sorry, 唔該曬。咁而家請提名嘅兩位議員，善仲佳議員。
With Mr. Sin Chung Kai and Mr. Chen Yunhan, who did the nomination, come forward. And witness the counting process. There should be altogether 15 ballot papers.
This is new, this looks like.呢個好似新喎，係嘛？好似見唔到。
透明度高啲，
少少變。冇，我哋宣布咗結束㗎啦嚇。嚇，冇得投票。
Voting is now closed. I've already announced that, so the latecomers cannot vote. Okay, now the vote counting begins. Number one.Number one. Number one. Number one. Number one. Number one? Number two, no. Yes, my mistake, said the chairman. Number one. Number two. Number two, again.
Hey, yo.
Number two. Number two. Number two. Number one. Number two. Number one. Number one.
以后.
Number two. You can see that. Let's count the votes again. You can see the outcome. Mr. Kenneth Leung, 8 votes. Mr. Wong Kok Kin, 7 votes. And announced Mr. Kenneth Leung, the chairman of the Bills Committee on Employment Amendment Bill 2014. Mr. Leung, would you please take the chair?
I just
want to know whether members want to have a vice chairman for the Bills Committee. For the Bills Committee. Well, if there is no need, then so be it.
All
right. We'll invite the government officials into the room. Good morning to the government officials. Without further ado, I will not introduce the officials. There are four of them. There is a list in front of you. I just want to ask members whether they want to propose meeting the deputations. Mr. Li Chiao-yan. Sorry, speakers aren't coming through. In fact, we have earmarked the 10th of May, a Saturday, starting from 9 a.m. to 12 noon for that purpose. If you think there are deputations whom you want to invite, please give the list or the names to the clerk. The date is the 10th of May. And we also, of course, will put everything on the internet to invite views in regard to this bill. The President of the Council, Mr. Chang Yuk-sing, issued a notice on dealing with the budget debate and also the amendments to the budget. We have received a lot of amendments. I have yet to decide on the date of next meeting. Members I've heard that many members do want this bill to be passed. That is just a hope. And whether that can be done, I don't know. They hope that this bill will be passed and enacted in within this term. I will give you a notice in writing on the date of next meeting, basing on how the legislative meeting, I mean full meeting, progress. Let me now invite the government officials to introduce the bill. Yes. First of all, I will introduce the Employment Amendment Bill 2014, its background, its major policy and major consideration, and then I will highlight the major provisions. The community attaches importance more and more on the role of father in the family, and members of public hope that the parent, father can be present when before or after the delivery of the new baby, and therefore they are calling for paternity leave. And the CE in his policy address also stated that the administration would like to complete the legislation for paternity leave. The Labour Department consulted the LAB after detailed consultation and discussion. Employees and employer representatives of the LAB agreed to legislation for paternity leave for 3 days, and the pay is 4/5 of the employee's average daily life. Paternity leave is similar to maternity leave. The LAB therefore agreed that where appropriate, the relevant requirements and details of paternity leave should be aligned with those applicable to maternity leave to ensure reasonableness and consistency of the employment ordinance. On the 16th January 2013, we consulted the panel, and according to the proposal, the father or father-to-be who have employed under a continuous contract and who has given advance notice to the employer is eligible to 3 days of paternity leave. And if the employee has been in continuous employment for more than 40 weeks, he is entitled to PL pay. We set it to 3 days because we have to take into account the cost of paternity leave, which will be borne by employers of different scales. We need to find a suitable balance. In 2012, the Labour Department consulted 18 human resource clubs of the members. The members of 18 human resource managers clubs, and according to the opinion survey, the majority are in favor of no more than 3 days, and only about 40% or so provide less than 3 days. And we are of the view that it is appropriate to set the paternity leave at 3 days. The proposal of the rate of PL pay is 4/5 of the normal pay. That's the same as maternity leave. Members of public are of the view that only the husband in a legal marriage can be entitled to PL. But if we don't allow PL for children born out of wedlock, then that may be a discrimination under because of family status, and that will be in breach of the law. And the employment ordinance does not require female employees to enjoy maternity leave only within a legal marriage. And therefore, basing on paternity leave, the male member who the male employee who is the legal father of the newborn baby will be eligible. There is no requirement of a legal marriage with the mother of the newborn baby. Therefore, the name of the employee has to be registered as the legal father on the birth certificate in order to enjoy PL.
And if the baby is not born in Hong Kong, the father may still need to take PL so that he can leave Hong Kong and take care of the mother as well as the newborn. So with regard to the birthplace of the newborn, there would not be any restrictions. In other words, documentary proof issued outside Hong Kong will be accepted. When the government makes the proposal concerning statutory PL, it has taken into account various factors, for example, employees' benefits, the affordability of employers, the need of the community, and the general practice in the private sector. It tries to ensure that a balance is struck between employers and employees. We hope that the legislature can pass this bill as soon as possible so that working fathers can enjoy this family-friendly policy as soon as possible. Thank you. We have several members who would like to ask questions. Mr. Tan Kap Piu, Wong Kwok Hing, and Lee Chuck Yan. Tan Kap Piu, Wong Kwok Hing, Lee Chuck Yan, Hock Wai Kang, Tommy Chang, Poon Siu Ping. 5 minutes each, including questions and answers. Mr. Tang first. Thank you, Chairman. Well, just now I heard from the Assistant Commissioner for Labour saying that this policy is to benefit newborns, but 3 days are really not enough. I think 7 days would be adequate. Well, because for the employees in Hong Kong, actually, they have a very busy work life. They have to learn a lot when it comes to learn how to take care of newborns. So when a father takes a newborn home, he will start to learn a lot of new skills. So 3 days are not enough. I remember when I was a father, for the first time, I also took 7 days leave. You said that after 1 year, this policy will be reviewed. So do you have this thinking in mind? That is, after the implementation of this, will you conduct another round of public consultation regarding the prolonging of the PL, and there is no commencement date in the paper. Now, of course, we have to be very cautious because we are members of the Bills Committee, but do you have a timetable in mind when it comes to the commencement date? Now, I discovered that when it comes to amendments to the Employment Ordinance, you have adopted a very strange practice. That is, when the new measure benefits workers, you would drag your feet. And so these are the questions that I want to ask you. That is, whether there will be another round of public consultation and whether the 3 days will be lengthened. And our legal advisor has also raised 3 points. The paper number is 1294. It is about the calculation of paternity leave pay, mode of taking paternity leave, etc. And there are also questions about babies born outside Hong Kong. And if unfortunately the baby dies, it will be very difficult to acquire documentary proofs in other jurisdictions. So what kind of legal framework will be handling this kind of disputes? Would it be the LAB, or would it be the coroner's court, or will it be the family court? There are several questions. First of all, about the number of days, 3 days. Now we set it at 3 days. Now, because the LAB has already reached a consensus, there have been several rounds of discussion concerning the number of days. Both employers and employees talked a lot about this. And then in the November 2012 meeting, a consensus was reached, that is 3 days. And we have looked at the private sector, and some companies now offering PL on a voluntary basis, and most of them are offering 3 days. 81% of the companies offer 1 to 3 days of PL. This is on a voluntary basis. So as a starting point, we think 3 days are adequate. We have undertaken that after this piece of legislation has commenced, after a year, we will conduct a review and we will report to the LAB and there will be discussions again. And of course, we will again report to the Electricals Manpower Panel about the result of the discussion. As for commencement date, of course, we wanted to commence as soon as possible. And we want the bill to be passed by Electrical as early as possible, because by doing so, employees can benefit as early as possible. And that's another question. If there are disputes, for example, for the documents provided by the employees, whether they are accepted by the employers or not, because there are different practices in different jurisdictions, so this bill cannot be exhaustive. So we just set out a principle. That is, if there's a birth certificate, the certificate should be provided. And if there's no birth certificate, we hope that there can be documents provided by the relevant authorities so as to prove that the male employee is a legal father. And if the child is stillbirth, and if the documents can be accepted by both employers and employees, of course, that would be okay. Otherwise, the case would be referred to the Labor Disputes Tribunal. Next, Mr. Wong Kwok-hing. Thank you, Chairman. Chairman, I'm very happy today. I have brought with me a toy baby when I make a speech here. This baby has been with me for 9 years. When I made petition 9 years ago, I already brought it. I was the first legislator that urged the government to legislate for PL. As a father, I really have a profound feeling about this. When my boy or my baby was born, I bought a drumstick for my wife, and my wife told me that that drumstick was the most delicious one that she has ever eaten. She ate this drumstick in a hospital after giving birth to our baby. So as a father, I really have this deep feeling. As a father, when his child is born, if the father can care directly for his wife and the newborn, then this kind of deep feeling will never fade, even after decades. So I think having PL is very important. Because a father needs to know how his baby is born. He has to witness it. He has to ensure the safety of his wife and the newborn. Now, if this baby toy were real, then now is 9 years old already. After 9 years, this bill eventually is introduced into the Legislative Council. So, Chairman, I am very happy, and I feel that eventually we can see this dream realized. Now, the government is submitting this bill today, and it's about a 3 days paid PL, and the pay is set at 4/5 of the employee's average daily wages. I'm not too satisfied with this. However, we started from scratch, and now we see this breakthrough. So I think this can be accepted. The FTC thinks that the FTU thinks that the PL should be 7 days, but this is a breakthrough. So I still welcome it. We have been fighting for this for years. The last government, the former CE, also made a lot of efforts. So I would like to thank Mr. Donald Chang, because he was willing to implement this policy in the public sector. And on the 1st of April 2012, 5 days of PL were given to the male employees in the civil service. And in Liang Chenying's first policy address, he also said that legislation will be enacted as soon as possible. So I would also like to thank him. The LAB has also done a lot of work, and eventually it reached a consensus. Actually, this is not easy. Now we are trying to abolish the offsetting arrangement in the MPF system, and still it's not done. We still have to fight for more. If the government undertakes that, after a year there will be a review. So now I have a question for the Labour Department. Now, if the father cannot obtain legal documents to prove that he is the father, then he has to write a statement to his employer saying that now his child will be born and he has to take the PL. So if the employees or the employer does not accept that, how can the government help the employee? And will the employer be breaking the law if he does so? Now, according to the law, if the employer does not comply with the law and grant PL to the employee, then it's an offense, and the highest fine is $50,000. Now, Mr. Wong's question is that, now, if the baby is born outside of Hong Kong, and if the father cannot get documentary proof, now, there are certain requirements in the bill, right? So now the baby is born and there's no documentary proof, and if he just writes a statement to his employer and his employer does not accept, that's what can be done. I mean, when the father cannot get a documentary proof in time, so what can be done? Of course, if the employer says that's okay, of course that's no problem. However, not every employer is like that. Some may say that, well, I would not take this as a legal document, so those bills would arise. So what would happen? Maybe Ms. Luk can answer this question. Chairman, as for the whole piece of legislation, it is like this. The father, well, for the father, there are two types of scenarios. Now, if he has to take the PL, he would have to inform the employer. And the employer may say that, well, I do not know that you have a wife or a girlfriend. So can you give me some proof? So because at that time, the baby may not have been delivered, and he just wants to take leave for that purpose. So under such circumstances, the employee would have to provide a written statement stating that he is the legal father of the child. And after doing that, the employee already has the right to take the leave. The employer cannot reject that. As for the birth certificate, well, fathers are different from mothers because, well, for fathers, you cannot tell from his appearance that he's going to have a baby. And in particular, this time, we do not impose any restrictions on the marital status. So it might be difficult for the employer to know. So for the male employee, when he applies for the PL pay, he really has to provide a birth certificate, and on the birth certificate, his name would have to be entered as the child's father. So after getting the certificate, the employer would have to effect the PL pay to the employee. So for the PL, as long as both the employers and employees agree, then the employee can take the PL, and if there's a problem, then the employee would have to provide a written statement.
After the employee has handed in the slip of paper, so must the employer grant the leave? Yes, he must. Next, Mr. Li Chao-Yan. We have been fighting for PL for many years. It is a very important element in a family-friendly policy. There is a postnatal depression. It is very common. And one important contributing factor is that Hong Kong employees are suffering. They really don't have time to be with their families. As for a female employee, when she gives birth to a baby, her husband is usually not by her side. So we need a family-friendly policy, and 3 days is a policy to mean. You have a policy of encouraging people to give birth. Paternity leave, first of all, should be full pay. That's the position of the Labour Party. And also, there should also be a paternity leave. But if you just give a 3-day paternity leave, what's the point of having a leave? Now, we are asking for 7 days of paternity leave, and we believe that is an appropriate period so that the husband can give full support to his wife. But the administration only gives 3 days. Now, you inclined towards the employers. How many babies are born each year? Maybe about 30,000 or so. And how many of these babies? Well, there may be babies born outside Hong Kong, born to Hong Kongers, since there are many cross-border marriages. How many of the employees are male employees? Now, if the employer has a baby, then he or she will deal with the maternity or paternity leave, himself or herself. But what about the male employees who are not civil servants? How many of them are there? What's the cost on the employers of the private sector? Among 2.7 million employees, how many can enjoy paternity leave? How many paternity leave can one have in one's lifetime? People usually have one or two children in a family, so should you be so mean? Well, except Mr. Dr. Kenneth Chan. you are a special case, Dr. Chan. I just want to know the numbers. Thank you, Chairman. Concerning the numbers, in 2010, number of babies born in Hong Kong and their parent and the local fathers working in the private sector, 46,500, or 3% of the male employees in Hong Kong. That they were employees, first of all, in 2010, including civil servants. No, excluding civil servants. Okay, it's very clear. Throughout Hong Kong, just 46,500, or 3% of the working population. Among the 2.7 million employees, only 3%, 3% of the male employees, or maybe 1.6, 1.7 of the total labor force. Well, if just 1.6% of your employee are to have that paternity leave, that would of course increase the cost, but from a macro point of view, that's really a small number. Why can't the administration look at it from this perspective. Cost is not too high. On one hand, you need to encourage births, you need to be family friendly. On the other hand, employers will have to pay a little bit more. On balance, why can't you favor a longer maternity leave? As said by member, we're starting from zero. The first step is by providing 3 days. And we hope that after implementation, we conduct a review within a year or after a year. Next, Mr. Kwok Wai Kong.
的確啊，即係睇翻過去嘅歷史咧，都一段好長好長嘅時間。咁啊，終於喺而家呢個。
Okay, we have been fighting for this for a very long time. Now is the time for enacting the relevant legislation. Those who are longing for this will welcome this enthusiastically. The starting point of a 3 day leave is too low.The trial within the civil service is a period of 5 days. Why? In the private sector, the employees are second class to the civil servants. It's unfair. We hope the administration will conduct a review as soon as possible. There should be a review every year on how to implementthe PL, and also deal with the low starting point.
第一個就係有關於文件第十段嘅嚇。咁其實
My question is concerning paragraph 10, and there was a dispute at the Labour Advisory Committee, right? But Labour Advisory Board, and we did discuss that before as well, and that is the issue of miscarriage and stillbirth cases.As for the distinction between miscarriage and stillbirth, I think that's a response to the dispute at the LAB. With regard to maternity leave, the provision in the law has been there over a long period of time. If paternity leaveThe provisions for paternity leave are bound by the provisions of maternity leave, then you are not flexible. You are bureaucratic. With regard to miscarriage and stillbirth cases, administrations adopt a more progressive approach or positive approach. Under the EO, miscarriageeven if there is a miscarriage, the employee can still, the female employee can still have maternity leave, but not for the male employee. The male employee will not be given a paternity leave. When there is a newborn baby, the family will share the joy, but then when there is a miscarriage, then the husband and wife will have to also have to face the sorrow.That follows the miscarriage. So why there is such a difference? And now my second question is in relation to the 4/5 of average pay. And my question is on calculation. Does it include commission? If you base your calculation on basic salary, that's very low. And in fact, commission.Is the major chunk of the income. So can you really deal with the problem with regard to 4/5 of average daily pay? If the baby is delivered within the first 28 months of confinement,and cannot survive, then it is regarded as a miscarriage. And if the pregnancy is more than 28 months, then it is regarded as a stillbirth case. if the pregnancy is before the 28 weeks of pregnancy, then there will not be maternity leave, nor will there be paternity leave. As for miscarriage, it may happen in the early weeks of pregnancy, and then there is no paternity leave, and sick leave will be may be granted. As for pregnancy after the 28th week, and then even if there is miscarriage or stillbirth, there is maternity leave, and there is also paternity leave. As for calculation of the pay, all items of wages are included, and commission is also included in the calculation. That's very clear in the law. The four-fifths includes commission. The calculation is rather complicated. It is the average income immediately, 12 months immediately before the leave. Mr. Hui, concerning 28 weeks, how do you come up with this line? 7 months. You mean if a baby less than 7 months is not regarded as a baby? Have you talked to the doctors on the definition of life? You say that before 28 weeks after miscarriage, nothing seems to have happened. How can that be? Chairman, 28 weeks of pregnancy is used as the definition for miscarriage under the employment ordinance. From the medical point of view, there are different definitions of miscarriage. We need to draw a line somewhere so that employers and employees we can have a reference. This rule of 28 weeks of pregnancy has been there since there is a provision for maternity leave. I know that, but you may have to look into that. A baby who is given birth at the 28th weeks of pregnancy can still survive. The employment ordinance is outdated, I think. But that's my personal suggestion. Mr. Tommy Chang, Chairman, as a representative of the employers, if I oppose it, I will be regarded as unkind. It's just 3 days and pay, is four-fifths. Well, Mr. Wong Kok Kin has got used to it. I don't support this because, in fact, we are suffering, the employers are suffering from one measure to the other. The administration says that it doesn't hit the employer. Now, we went to Shanghai. The officials in Beijing were concerned about populism. And what is worse than populism is to ask the employers to foot the bill and the government doesn't pay a cent. This government has got used to it. Whoever elected by a clique does the same. It's okay to give out money in order to get popular support. He made use of the money of paid by employers to win people's applause. Let me go back to the main issue. I hope the officials will not take it personal. I have nothing against you. If an employee has given a notice that he will take paternity leave and in the interim he is dismissed, then has he to be paid? Before he took the Before he takes the PL, he is dismissed. Well, he has to take the PL within his employment. But if he has given notice, then and if he dismissed, will the employer be found regarded as making an offence? No, it is not the case.
And about birth certificates, after an employee takes a PL, and if he wants to get a PL pay, he has to produce a birth certificate. And what if the employee fails to produce the birth certificates? Would that be a penalty? Would that be a reason for the employer to fire him because he has cheated the employer for several days of leave? Now, of course, if he cannot produce the birth certificates, there may be a lot of reasons. And the employment ordinance states that if the employee cheats or if he's dishonest, then the employer can fire him. Now, if a man says that, well, that's a woman who's going to give birth to my child, so he takes 3 days pill out, but then he goes to Japan with another girlfriend. So would that be regarded as a scam? The employer hears from you that a woman is going to give birth to your baby, and he gives you 3 days PL. So would that be a reason for firing the employee? Is this in the employment court ordinance? In section 9 of the employment ordinance, conditions are set out as to how an employer can fire an employee without giving him advance notice. That is, if he's dishonest or if he cheats. And for birth certificates, I would also like to ask a question, because there are a lot of people with the same names. We used to have a colleague called Malik, and then there was a fugitive that was also called Malik. So for a birth certificate issued on the mainland, now they have a single Chinese word as family name and a single Chinese word as name. So there may be a lot of people who are sharing the same names, but they are not the same person. Now, there may not be many people who are called Zheng Yuan, but there may be many people who are called Zheng Yu or Zheng Yan. So how can you prove that it's the same person? If the employee forged a document or used a forged document, then it's a criminal offense. He's subject to prosecution. Well, Chairman, let me answer this question, because I do not want to ask a second round questions. Now, as for childbirths outside of marriage, I think you are really too lenient, and I am not happy with it. Mr. Pun Xiuping, well, the labor sector has been fighting for PL for a long time, so we really hope that this bill can be implemented as early as possible. Now, in the public sector or for the civil service, the male employees enjoy a 5-day PL, so there is still a great discrepancy here. Just now, we talked about miscarriage, and people have different views concerning it. Well, miscarriage is, of course, unfortunate, and the wife really needs the care of her husband. And you are saying that the pregnancy would have to exceed 28 weeks to be regarded as stillbirth instead of marriage. So I hope that improvements can be made in the future. I would like to ask a question. Now, in the employment ordinance, an employer cannot fire an employee because she is pregnant. So there is certain protection for the women. So would adjustment be made to this bill? It says that, well, during the PL, if the employee is fired, what would happen? Of course, when you asked Mr. Tommy Chung, you said that nothing would happen. And I would like to know more about the provision, because this is also about pregnancy protection. And for 15C in the bill, you say that PL cannot be replaced by money. So can there be more protection? Otherwise, in the future, there may be disputes between employers and employees concerning this. Mr. Hui, with regards to employee protection, well, maternity leave is quite different from PL. Well, pregnant women enjoy 10 weeks ML, and the physical condition may also make the woman weak so that she cannot work before the actual delivery date. So for the prospective father, his work performance should not be affected by his wife's pregnancy. So there should be no physical problem. And for PL, then we are only talking about 3 days. And if we prohibit the employer from firing the prospective father just because of this three days leave, is unfair. So for an employee taking PL, it should not serve as a shield to protect him from being fired. Well, money and leave are two different things when it comes to PL. When the employee should give sufficient notification to the employer, and if he's employed under a continuous contract, then he's entitled to PL. As to whether he can get the PL pay, well, he should have worked for that employer for 40 weeks continuously, and he should also be able to provide a birth certificate. So these are two different issues. So if the employer does not grant the PL to the employee, he would have already violated the law, and he's subject to a maximum fine of $50,000. Mr. Poon, I would like to ask a question to follow up on yours. Now, of course, there should be documentary proof, but I think Dr. Poon's question is like that. So other than giving you the 4/5 pay, I do not want you to take the leave. If I give you double pay and I don't give you any PL, would that be okay? Well, the PL is the right of the employee. As long as he gives advance notification, he should be able to take the PL. Well, what if the employer says that I give you double pay and you don't take the 3 days leave? And if the employee agrees, what would happen? Would the employer be violating the law? Can the employer do that? According to the law, the employee should notify the employer in advance. Now, if he does not notify the employer in advance, he does not have the right to take the PL. I don't think you're answering my question. Now, if the employee has notified the employer that he's going to take PL, and the employer says that I'll give you 3 times your pay, don't take the PL. Now, of course, the employee can reject that and still takes his PL, but if the employer and employee agrees and the employee does not take the leave, instead he gets more money. So under such circumstances, would it be legal? Now, if you cannot answer my question, please answer my question later in writing or consult your legal advisor. Under these circumstances, what would happen? Would the employer and employee be allowed to do so? I'm not talking about the pay setting at 4/5. Next, Ms. Chang. Well, the DAB welcomes this. Now the employer and the employee have agreed on legislating for PL. Well, it shows that employers should always talk with employees, and they can always come up with a satisfactory result. Now, from employees' perspective, I think this is really something good. It's not just about the male employee. And from a female's point of view, well, when a woman is at the weakest moment and she really needs her husband to be by her side, now this new piece of legislation allows the husband to spend 3 days with her. So I think this is really good. But I would like to have some points clarified. For childbirths outside of Hong Kong, well, you need the employee's written statement or a doctor's certificate. Well, can the employer ask for a birth certificate? That's the employer has the right to ask the employee to produce a birth certificate. Well, in the law, it states that if the child is born outside Hong Kong, and if the authorities at that place do not issue, well, if they issue birth certificates, then of course he should produce a birth certificate. But if that place does not issue birth certificates, then the employee would have to provide a documentary proof from the authorities at that place. Well, are there, do you know, there are places that do not issue birth certificates? Well, I think of most of the places they would issue birth certificates, but of course we cannot be exhaustive. Maybe there are some remote and backward areas they do not do this. Well, if this happens, then would the employee be violating a certain provision, and what's the penalty? Now, for the documentary proof, if the employer is suspicious, or if the employer and the employee have disputes over the documentary proof, then the Labor Department would try to mediate. And if the problem cannot be resolved, then it would be referred to the LAB or the Small Claims Tribunal, the Labor Tribunal or the Small Claims Tribunal. Well, for the nature of the document, if there is disputes, that is whether the employee is really the legal father of the child, then it will be a civil case. But if there are evidences showing that the employee is using a forged document, then this would be a criminal case. I will read out the names of the members who are going to ask questions. Chung Kok-Pen, Chen Yun, and Chen Chi-Chin, and Chen Ka-Lok. Any other members would like to ask questions? Yes, I see you, Lei Chai-Yan. Chung Kok-Pen. Thank you, Chairman. I am a father, and I still remember my feeling as the father of a newborn. Well, some members say that 3 days are not enough. You need 7 days. You have to learn how to take care of a baby. But even 7 days would not be enough. Taking care of a baby is actually a long-term job. So for 3 days, I think it's just a good intention of the employer so that they can give time to the father so that he can take care of the wife. Now, for paragraph 16, you talked about childbirths outside Hong Kong. And the father can still enjoy the 3-day PL. Now, in Guangdong province, if the father wants to take care of the wife and baby, that would also be allowed. If your baby is born in Guangdong, then of course, if you take 3 days PL, you can visit your wife and the baby. But what if your baby is born in Canada or the US? 3 days would never be sufficient. Even by taking the plane, you will need 3 days. So what if the employee's baby is born in Canada or the US? And also another member has asked this question. Now, if the employer gives you money, buy back to appeal from you, what will happen? But what if the employee is willing to sell his PL? Would he be breaking the law? Now, he has the entitlement of this 3 days PL, but what if he wants to sell it?
Concerning the three days of leave, if the baby is born in another place, there may not be enough time to make a round trip in 3 days. Well, the employer can, an employee can make an agreement. And it is up to the decision of the employee on how to make use of the 3 days of paternity leave. Now, if the employee asks to sell his PL, the employer doesn't need to do so. The employer has the responsibility to grant PL. And if adequate document is provided, then the PL pay will be given. Mr. Chong, do you have any follow-up? Yes, Chairman. Let me reconfirm this. The 3 days of leave, concerning the 3 days of leave, if he can provide the documentary proof, then you just don't care whether the 3 days are spent on caring for the baby or for the wife. He is entitled to 3 days leave. And this is just that. Mr. Hoi. As for how detailed the care is, it cannot be put down in the law and require the person to do such and such during the leave. That may cause legal disputes. That may cause disputes between employers and employees. Therefore, the law does not prescribe what should be done or what shouldn't be done during those 3 days. Next, Ms. Chen Yunhan. Sorry, the speaker is not coming through. My first question is this. The pay on PL is just 4/5. That's not fair. I have been talking about it, complaining about it for more than 10 years. Why don't you take this opportunity to improve the law concerning the pay of 4/5? The next question is related to miscarriage and stillbirth. Incapable of survival after born. Why is it so? Even if the baby is born and then after a few days, if this is a stillbirth case or a miscarriage before, the D-date, then that is still very sad thing. Why don't you consider that? I hope you will take that into account in the law. Mr. Hoi, with regard to PL, 4/5 of pay, 4/5 of the average pay, that's similar to similar employee benefits such as maternity leave, sick leave, and also sick leave upon injury at work. There are two types of leaves under the EO. One type is that everyone can enjoy that as long as you serve a certain period of time, such as statutory holidays and annual leaves. They are full pay leaves. Another type of holidays isn't given to everybody. It's only given under special circumstances, such as sickness or such as sick leave or paternity leave or maternity leave. So we adopt the same approach. And that is a standardized approach. As for full pay for maternity leave, we've considered the provisions in other countries and also the ILO conventions. According to the ILO convention, it only requires 2/3 of the pay. In Hong Kong, we are better than the ILO convention. In other places, such as the pay may just be a certain proportion of the pay for maternity leave or for paternity leave. As for stillbirth, before or after birth is not just 1 day or 2 days in before or after the delivery. The line is drawn at the 28th week of pregnancy. say if it is still miscarriage after the 28th week, then there will be paternity leave and maternity leave as well. Okay, I'll reflect on this concerning the handling of stillbirth. You draw a line at about 27 weeks. That's about 7 months. I have to listen to the views of the labor sector.
你好像振振有詞地說，我國際的什麼都是這樣，有些地方例如中國某些地方都。
Well, as for forfeits, in fact, in you say that in other parts of the world they may not pay give full pay, but in China, in parts of China, they give full pay. Now you regard this similar to that of sick leave, but I think even sick leave should enjoy full pay. Is the question is whether it's reasonable or not. We have been fighting for that for more than 10 years. Why doesn't the administration consider that? Are the employers unwilling or are you unwilling? Well, our labor laws based on a balance between the interests of work employers and employees, and also the interests of the public, and also general economy, and we are moving gradually forward. Well, there is no gradual progress. There is none. You started at 4/5, and there has been no progress so far. So don't use the wrong word. Mr. Hoi, for progressive, we mean the overall provisions in the law. There is no progression. It's at the start, it was 4/5. Originally, it was 2/3. That was decades and decades ago. And yes, we moved from 2/3 to 4/5. We don't agree with the 3 days, and it should at least be 5 days. Please go back and consider that. Mr. Chen Qijian, thank you, Chairman. We support the legislation for legislation on paternity leave, and we want full pay, and the number of days should be from five or even 7 days. From the point of view of gender equality and sex orientation, we should look at it this way. This is called PL under 3A. It is PL for male. I'm not asking you to give me an answer today. I just ask whether you have considered the gender equality perspective. If not, then it should be included in the future. I am afraid that it will be challenged by law if you have not considered it from gender perspective. Now, it is paternity leave. That means female is for males, and females are not able to enjoy that. But two females have the right to form a family. Now, children born outside marriage can enjoy that. You don't need to mention anything about marriage. And you have no restriction whether the baby is born outside marriage or not. And you have no restriction that the baby must be born in Hong Kong. Say if Lady A and Lady B formed a family, Lady A is pregnant, can Lady B has paternity leave? Now, Lady A is pregnant. Egg came from Lady B, so she is the mother. Lady B is the mother, or Madam B is the mother. But Madam B definitely will not have paternity leave under the law because this is paternity leave for male. I just want to point out this gender equality perspective. Has the administration considered that in process? Ms. Lok. In the process, we have only made reference to different discrimination ordinances, and we've taken into account the gender discrimination ordinance, the sex discrimination ordinance, and also family discrimination family status discrimination ordinance. We have considered the point raised by Mr. Chen in terms of the spirit of paternity leave. we are giving it, giving paternity leave to the father who will care for the baby. We're talking about the father. And when we consider the father, we can only consider the law in Hong Kong. We can only consider the local law. In Hong Kong, whether it is under family law, and also whether it is under birth and death registration law, and the confirmation or validation of documents, validation of relationship, validation of legal liability, we can only make reference to local law. And under family law in Hong Kong, when the term father is refers to, the father is a male.
法裏面呢,我會寫返係,即係咁樣係一個男性僱員,咁當然呢,即係咁樣講嘅時候呢,我哋the
father is a male employee. We cannot rule out the possibilities on the whole if there is a change in the family law. Then this law, the law then will be reviewed. Chairman, I raise this point. I'm not fighting for paternity leave for the mother. I just want to ask the Bureau whether it has considered that. In overseas countries, is there any example in which the mother has paternity leave? Have you done any study on that? Now, this legislation also covers children born out of marriage, and there is no restriction on day, and also there is no restriction on the place of birth of the baby. Will that lead to any challenge in future against this law? We have considered the experience overseas. Now, in this regard, the nature of leaves are different. Now, this time is about paternity leave. That is about the need of the baby before and after delivery. In overseas, they grant leave on parental responsibility. And when it talks about parental responsibility, it is about the relationship between a couple, and also the leave is rather long, and their experience is not applicable to Hong Kong. Next, Mr. Dr. Kenneth Chan. The Civic Party, of course, welcome the legislation on paternity leave and paid paternity leave. And many citizens have doubts whether a three-day leave is too mean and too short. I believe that in the subsequent discussions of the Bills Committee, this will be further discussed. And there is a need to listen to the views of employers, employees, labor unions, employer unions. Now, it's said that the Labor Party did a survey in 2012. The survey was done through the member establishments of its 18 resources managers club. And then the institution, the organizations grant PL from 1 day to 14 days. The average is 3 days, and they account for about 40% of the organizations responded. We can see that many organizations to grant such a concession. As a father, I can tell you that 3 days are not enough. And there are a lot of things that have to be considered. On the you don't just press a button and the baby is delivered. If you think 3 days, I think that's too short. I understand the point of employers. So you will also take your annual leave together with the PL. We all know that. And that's the first point. concerning 3 days, many employers and employees are using other means, say, for example, annual leave. I don't know whether you have given us the information in this regard, say, how many days have been taken? I can tell you how many days I took for each of my five children.
So did the survey cover this? Now you are setting the pay at 4/5 of the employee's average daily wages. And of course, if he also takes other leave days together with the PL, then of course the pay would not be 4/5 again. So for this paper, another previous paper, you're just telling us a simple average figure. So have you conducted a thorough survey? Did you have enough data? Because that would really help. So for that report, I hope you can give it to us. If it has not been made open yet, maybe it's the time to give the report to us. Well, you say that some employers are even giving 14 days of PL to their male employees. So this is all a voluntary basis. So what is the arrangement like? And for that 3 days, would that 3 days be actually part of the annual leave? So what kind of arrangements do the employers and employees have in the private sector? I want to know more details. So can the government give these data to the Bills Committee so that we can take a closer look? Now, the Civic Party thinks that this is a good start, and we hope that after the review, the 3 days can be extended to 5 days. Mr. Hui? Now, for that survey, well, the Human Resources Managers Clubs did it, and it provided the information to us. So for the law, now we are trying to set a minimum level. This is the minimum protection. And if employers want to attract talents to work for them, and if they want to retain such talents, of course, they would even offer better benefits. In 2012, we conducted this survey. We could see that some employers in the private sector were already doing this. We hope that by legislating, we hope that all the companies can comply. And some companies are already providing a PL longer than 3 days. We hope that they can keep that. So what was the PL pay rate in the private sector when we conducted a survey? 98% of them provided full pay, and 4/5 is the minimum. So for sick leave or maternity leave, some companies are now already offering full pay. So for the pay we set out, we hope it's the minimum. Of course, we hope that the employers can give the employees more benefits. Well, can you wait for the second round? I want to know whether they will give us the report. Yes, the report can be provided to you, and a summary will be provided. Ms. Sithole? Well, of course, I think 3 days are too short. I would like to ask the government. Now, when you first consider providing PL, there was an objective. You want to help families create better support for their family members, and you want to help pregnant women more so as to prevent and depression. But 3 days are really not enough, and maybe the baby is still in a hospital in an incubator. Now, of course, Mr. Professor Chen has a lot of experiences, but for a new father, well, suddenly there's a child at home, the man can really panic. Now, if you give him 3 days to get accustomed to this, it's really not enough, because there is this fragile newborn at home. It's really difficult. So for after above depression, it's not only suffered by women, men can also suffer from that. So I think the husbands and wives should support each other, and also the father should be given time to build up his relationship with the baby. So 3 days are definitely not enough. Can the government explain to us what's the legislative intent? Can you explain to me why 3 days are sufficient to achieve this intent? You cannot say that you have to balance the interest between the employers and the employees, and this is the only number of days that the employers are willing to grant. And also, I would like to ask about figures. Now, for miscarriage, you have talked about 28 weeks. You explained to us why. And then in paragraph 12, notification requirement. You say that the employee should notify his employer at least 3 months before the expected date of delivery of the child. So 12 months are actually less than 3 months, or 12 weeks are less than 3 months. This is not consistent. So you're saying that if a child is born before 28 weeks, that would be regarded as miscarriage, and PL and ML would not be granted. So these numbers do not tally. Can you use weeks as the unit? Otherwise, there will be inconsistency, and it may give rise to disputes. Mr. Hui, for 3 months, actually, it is suggested by the employer representatives at the LAB, because the employer can plan in advance. Well, it's different from ML, because for a lady, well, just by looking at her, you know that she's pregnant. However, for PL, if the employee doesn't say anything, the employer will not be in the know. He will never know that his employee will be a father. So he needs to be notified in advance so that he can plan ahead in terms of manpower deployment, etc. So this is why we set it at 3 months, and we also set this in accordance with the views of the LAB. Now, you want to improve family relationship, right? That's why you legislate. So why are you trying to convenience the employers all the time? And if this is a payout, you should use week as the unit. 3 months are actually 13 weeks and 1 day. In particular, there's another restriction of 28 weeks of pregnancy concerning miscarriage. So you should use the same unit. Well, you are using 3 months because you want to convenience the employers. However, if unfortunately there is really a miscarriage case, then there may be disputes due to this inconsistency. And under normal circumstances, although you won't see the male employee getting pregnant, it's very likely that the office would know, because he will be a father-to-be, he will be very happy and will be telling people. So I think the way of calculation should be more consistent. Well, of course, we want to ask more questions about 28 weeks. Why do you think that when a woman has a miscarriage, she actually needs more care and help from her husband? So you should have a legislative intent. You should really think through it. Are you really trying to meet people's needs? For the legislative intent, we hope that by legislating, fathers to be can take a PL before and after the delivery of the baby so that he can take care of his wife and the newborn. But maybe the newborn is still in an incubator after 3 days. Well, Mr. Ho, please ask your question in the second round. Mr. Sin Chong Kai? Well, are there statistics about delivery of babies in Hong Kong and how many days do the pregnant women stay in the hospital? Will 3 days be an average figure of the hospitalization? Ms. Luk? We do not have the relevant statistics. Well, because some babies are born in public hospitals, some are in private hospitals. But I would like to make this point. For an employee, as to when he wants to take the PL, actually he can make his own decision. Now, because in this bill, he can take the PL within 4 weeks before the delivery or within 10 weeks after the delivery of the baby. So he can look at the condition of the baby and then he make a decision. Now, if the baby is in a hospital and maybe he doesn't need to take pay leave, when the baby returns home, it would be better for him to take the PL. So the employee himself can make the decision. So he can choose that 3 days. Well, because a laboring can start quite abruptly, and the father would be very nervous and he would have to accompany his wife to the hospital. He doesn't know how long he would have to stay in a hospital. So are the 3 days a mean? Of course, you can make an appointment and do a cesarean operation. So have you looked at all these conditions? Will 3 days be really sufficient? If you do not have the relevant statistics, and how do you come up with the 3 days? So are you really trying to solve this caring problems for the fathers to be? Well, I thought that you had a very scientific calculation when you come up with this decision of 3 days, because for natural delivery normally would only take the woman would only stay in a hospital for 3 days, or is it because just the employers want it to be 3 days? Now, when we set the 3 days, well, we also rely on certain statistics. We conducted a survey, and the 18 human resources managers clubs conducted a survey, and before the legislation, Some companies in the private sector were already providing PLs, and the average number of days of PL they provide is 3 days. Most of them are 3 days or under 3 days. So the LAB looked at this data, and also a consensus was reached between employers and employees, and so that's why we set 3 days. So you ask the employers how many days of PL you are granting to your employees. So that's not a scientific research. Well, how much time is needed for a normal delivery, and how many days would a woman be staying in hospital? Would it normally be three or four days or what? You haven't looked into those figures. So if it's a cesarean operation, you can control the time. I'm sorry about the words I use. So anyway, it's an operation and it's not a natural delivery. So for natural delivery, how many days would a pregnant woman normally spend in a hospital? I think the private hospitals, the public hospitals would have such statistics. So how come you do not get the figures from them? Now, the intention of providing PL is not only allowing the father to accompany his wife. He may have other things to do, for example, trying to apply for the birth certificates, or there are other needs. So it's not just for him to accompany his wife in the hospital. That's why we do not have those figures. And we are setting it at 3 days now, because this is a consensus reached by the LAB and is based on a survey.
Ms. Emily Lau. I support providing more leaves to the employees. In fact, the employers will also be benefited if the employers have a group of happy employees, and the productivity will also be enhanced. Mr. Chen mentioned that he has a need. I have had that experience in my ward office. As for maternity leave, we pay full pay for 14 weeks, and paternity leave, 14 days full pay. You know how much money we have. You know our monthly honorarium. Even if we don't have much money, I believe we are willing to provide good terms. Now, some follow that of international organizations. Are many employers objecting to that? Do you see any difficulties on their part? Thank you, Chairman. Concerning the 3 days, it's a period agreed upon by employers and employees. There are big organizations, there are small organizations. For small organizations, we've heard that they have difficulties. The SMEs have just a few employees. The majority of the employees may be males. Although only 3% of the employees on the whole get paternity leave, basing on demographic data. If by coincidence, several employees take paternity leave in the same period, then these SMEs will have difficulties with their operation. In setting the length for PL, we need to take into account various factors, and we will conduct a review after the law has been there for a year. The LAB will then discuss the matter. Chairman, I hope that the administration will first set a good example, set a better example, and the administration should tell the employers the merits of being good to employees. In my ward office, we only have 10 employees. We don't have a big team. The leave, of course, is good to the employees. It's also good to the organization itself and also to the community at large. I understand that if there are big difficulties, if employees have to take leave at the same time, then the problem has to be addressed. But not too many organizations face this issue. Can you be more generous? The Labor Department has all along been encouraging employers to provide terms that are better than the minimum requirement of the law. And I agree with the member that if the employer is able to provide more favorable terms, in fact, that will lead to a win-win situation for both the employer and the employees. We will encourage employers to be generous. Now, without the law, even without the law, there are employers who are providing paternity leave up to 14 days. I am one of them. So, if employers want to retain talents, well, I don't need to retain talents. I find it strange. They say they are these employers and enlightened employers, but I think they should be the standard. So many are not enlightened. It's the administration telling the administration, the council, that many employers are not enlightened. We are a world city. Well, many employers provide terms that are better than the law. If that is the case, then why don't you set a higher standard in the law and let them provide terms that are better than the law? As I stressed, we have the minimum standard in the law. We cannot require, we require the employers, whatever their shapes and sizes, have to provide the at least the requirement of the law. Li Chaoyan, Tan Ka Piu, Sit Ho want to ask second round. Do other members want to have a second round? If not, then I'll draw a line there and 5 minutes each. Li Chaoyan. Thank you, Chairman. I think the setting of 3 days is rather flimsy. You only ask 18 members of the Human Resources Managers Clubs, and then you come to this conclusion. You do not, or you did not, consider the needs of the parents who are to welcome their newborn babies. You just considered the view of 18 organizations. Why don't you ask the LegCo members here? If we say 7 days, then we are more than. If you ask all the LegCo members, then I think you get more than 18 people who are willing to provide more than 3 days. Why can't there be a family-friendly policy which enables the parents to take care of the newborn babies? The second question is related to Mr. Tommy Chung's question whether the person can be dismissed. There is no protection in this law, but I think we should look at it from the perspective of family status, discrimination. I don't know whether you've talked to the EOC. Say, if I've make a submission for PL and I am therefore dismissed, then is there a breach of the FSDO, Family Status Discrimination Ordinance? It's because of my family status that I have to take PL, and if I'm dismissed because of that, then the employer has committed an offense. Is it the case? Now, concerning the 46,500 male employees who to take paternity leave, not all of them may be eligible. 46,500 is only the broad number. Some may not have worked for the same employer for more than 40 weeks, so they are not entitled. So assuming that they are 40,000, 40,000 times 3 days will be the total cost. And what is this in proportion to the total number of man days within the labor force? And I believe that is not a significant proportion. You can show people the numbers. You can show how mean you are. Can you give me the numbers today? Mr. Hoi, let me clarify this. The so-called 18 human resources managers clubs covering 1,580 member establishments. We issued 1,580 organizations. The employer has to comply with the employment ordinance. He or she has to comply with other laws such as the Family Status Discrimination Ordinance. If an employee is dismissed on the grounds of family status discrimination, then it is in breach of the law. He has the liability. It doesn't mean that he has complied with the EO, that's the end of the story. Although there is no provision in the EO, there are other provisions in other laws, and he is also regulated by those laws. As for the 46,500 male employees, that's only a preliminary estimate. When we made the estimate, there was no provision in the law. No conditions were set by then. The amount of, but according to our estimate, if these 46,000 odd employees took 3 days of PL, then the amount of money involved is about $140 million, which was equivalent to 0.02% of total wages. That's exactly what I mean. I guess it was 0.01%. Although it's 0.02%, it's a very small sum, and why you still want to haggle over it? Well, if 0.02% is, then it's really very, very small. You really need to deal with this so-called actual burden on the employer. My concern is about employment protection. In fact, the question was raised by Mr. Porn and followed up by Mr. Li Chao-Yan. If the reference is the benefits for maternity leave for female employees, why can't you apply the same conditions in respect of dismissal? The family is to have a newborn baby, and there is a new economic burden. The employer will not say, because you have a new baby, I dismiss you. Now, if for maternity leave, there is no ground to dismiss the employee. Whatever reason will not be acceptable. If you dismiss a female employee who is entitled to, who is having her maternity leave, on the grounds of maternity leave. But paternity leave, that can be possible. But now the world has changed. There are male breadwinners as well as female breadwinners, and the father may have to care for the family. Now, if I ask you to work overtime, will you say no? If I ask you to work longer hours, will you dare to reject if you have a child? I think there should be a protection given for those who are to take PL. The reference is to maternity leave. There shouldn't be two different standards as far as protection of employment is concerned. Mr. Hoi, the agreement at the LAB is that wherever applicable, the terms for PL should make reference to ML. Maternity leave. The protection given to maternity leave is based on the special features of maternity leave. Say, during pregnancy, the female worker cannot do laborious jobs, and the paternity leave is 10 weeks. There is an incentive for the employer to dismiss the employee. As for paternity leave, it's different. The pregnancy will not have any impact on the productivity of the father. And paternity leave is very short. If an employer wants to save the 3 days of PL and dismiss the male employee, that's very unlikely because incentive is not high. If we are to give proportion protection to the employee who is to take PL from any dismissal, that is really out of proportion. As for paternity, as for maternity leave, and also you can see that the female employee is pregnant, but as but for paternity leave, the male employee can just make a notice, and therefore it is very difficult to introduce a protection arrangement. Having considered all these, we think that it's not suitable to give protection on maternity leave, on paternity leave.
Well, can you say more about the Family Status Discrimination Ordinance? Now, if an employer fires his employee because of his family status, well, in the employment ordinance, it doesn't say that he cannot fire him. However, if that act of dismissal is against the Family Status Discrimination Ordinance, then that will still be a problem. Well, the labor union's view is that, well, you don't even have to go to the Equal Opportunities Commission because it will take them at least half a year to solve a very simple case. So, for sick leave and injury leave, there are protections, and women are also protected with maternity leave. So how come men are not protected? Well, maybe this bill's committee can write a letter to the EOC and seek their view. If you think that is appropriate, I can do that. Next, Ms. Sitho. Thank you, Chairman. I would like to ask a question about paragraph 9, childbirths outside of marriage. Just now, Mr. Chen Shih-chin said that if there are two women, they form a family, and one of them is going to give birth to a baby, so how come the other one cannot get PL? Well, at the Electoral Commission, I also asked this question. Before this bill was gazetted, the commission of the LegCo was already a very good employer, and we've decided on granting PL. And I said that, well, we should be the best employer. We should give equal opportunities to people with different sexual orientations. So our commission is not that avant-garde yet because my opinion was not accepted by the commission. And I would like to ask a question about paragraph 9. You say that there are sex discrimination ordinance and family status discrimination ordinance. So failing to grant PL for childbirths outside of marriage might constitute discrimination under these two ordinances. I think there's a written reply from the EOC, right? So I would like to see that. And also, when it comes to different sexual orientations, did EOC give you any view? Ms. Look, well, for Ms. Ho's question, when we drafted the bill, we have asked government councils. They have looked at human rights ordinance and other relevant ordinances, and they say that PL should not be restricted by marriage laws. So there was no need for us to consult the EOC because the government council already said that. So can the administration ask the EOC this? Now, paragraph 9, you say that, well, the male employee does not have to be a registered husband. I agree with the Department of Justice, that is, childbirths outside of marriage should also be covered. That is, you do not have to register your marriage in Hong Kong. So as long as he is the legal father, then that's okay. I agree to this point of law. But can you ask the EOC about this? That is, other than this point, how about different people with different sexual orientations? Now, for this legislative proposal, you have not covered the families in which the spouses are of the same sex. There are several ordinances under this EOC. Yes, I'm very clear about that. That is how many EOC ordinances there are. My question is not that whether this will be against the law, but you should ask the EOC if you do not cover people with different sexual orientations, would that be regarded as discrimination? Yes, we can consult the EOC, but the EOC does not have sexual discrimination, sexual orientation discrimination ordinance. Yes, yes, I'm very clear about that. But the EOC lately has said many things about different peoples of different sexual orientations. So if you do not cover this kind of families, would that be regarded as discrimination? Yes, please write to the EOC. Ms. Old, any other questions? Any other members who would like to ask second round questions? Mr. Jameson, you just entered. Do you have a question? Yes, Mr. Jameson. Well, Chairman, I'm not a member of this committee. We have Chung Kok Pan and Tommy Cheung from the Liberal Party sitting on this committee, and there are more than 20 members sitting on this committee, and there are not many representatives from the business sector. Well, on behalf of the Liberal Party, I would like to say a few words here. For PL, well, actually, the young people today don't really like a big family. At most, they would have two children. So as a father, if he just has two kids, then, well, there would just be several days PL, so it's not such a huge problem. But many SMEs have told me that it's very difficult to do business nowadays. But of course, the labor sector would like to see more protection. But you should also look at the business sector. Now we do not have the law yet. Well, it's quite rare to see that employers would refuse to grant a few days of leave for their male employers who are going to be fathers. So at the LAB, there are representatives from employers and employees and also from the government. They have had thorough discussions. Now for this 3 days, even after legislation, is just a minimum length of PL. And if there are indeed family problems, I'm sure most employers would be willing to grant their employees a few more days. It's not like that the male employer would be a new father every year and you have to grant him many, many days of PL. So as a representative of the business sector, I can't say that we would be very generous, but we would support the decision of the LAB and we would support the passage of this bill. So if there is no particular need, I hope that the male employees would take the 3 days PL. But of course, if there are difficulties, I also hope that the employers will cooperate. Well, it's about time to end the meeting, but I would like to summarize. Now, many members have asked a lot of questions, and the government would have to provide more information to us. Our legal advisor has sent you a letter on the 11th of April 2014. There are some technical questions and you have not responded to them yet, so please give us a reply in writing as soon as possible. And also, questions have been put to you. Now, if an employer and an employee make an agreement, that is, the employee will not take the PL, instead he will take money, would that be legal? And Professor Chen wants to see the Human Resources Managers Club's survey report, and you have agreed to give it to us. And Ms. Sidho wants you to consult the EOC. And she wants to know whether one of the discrimination ordinances is violated. Chairman, that's not true. I understand that there is no sexual orientation discrimination ordinance now, so this will not be a breach. So they should just ask the EOC whether this would constitute discrimination. Okay, so I didn't omit anything. As for the next meeting, as I said just now, we cannot decide a date yet because we will have to look at the arrangements of the council meeting because it's going to discuss the budget. And on the 10th of May, it's a Saturday, from 9 a.m. to 12 noon, there will be a public hearing, and we will invite deputations to come and express their views. So if you want to invite certain deputations, please give the list to the secretariat. Well, maybe we should invite the liberal-minded employers. Well, why don't you come? Well, you did not say that. I think we should communicate with them. Actually, this may be a good practice for the company itself. So are there any other questions? If not, we'll end the meeting here. Thank you.